Hey everybody, welcome to this video today where I'm going to talk about why vagus nerve stimulation can help with so many different health conditions. My name is Carissa Conrad and I'm a doctor of physical therapy and therapeutic pain specialist, and I am the vagus nerve PT. If you've been around on my channel before, you've seen me talk in my shorts and other videos about the research that supports the use of vagus nerve stimulation to address the symptoms and the root causes of a whole list of different illnesses that don't necessarily seem to have anything to do with one another. And you may have wondered, how is that the case? How can it be that one intervention can have an impact on so many different health conditions? And so I wanted to go into some detail today about why that is the case. So it's really interesting, as I do the work that I do, where I'm coaching people on their path to recovery from all different kinds of health conditions utilizing vagus nerve stimulation, there's a common theme in the stories that I hear over and over again. And that oftentimes is that they were a high-performing individual before they developed the illness. They were the type of person that pushed themselves really hard through school, were a top performer at work, potentially had a lot of childhood trauma. They were, you know, the mothers that had a million things up in the air at all times and still managed to do it all. And really what was going on is that they were that duck on the pond, right? On the surface, they looked very serene and calm. They looked like they had it all together. They were the go-to person for problem solving. And they were very, they looked very functional and they looked very accomplished. But underneath, the feet were going, right? So there's something driving them to be a high performer and to really ignore their body's signals and signs that maybe it was time to slow down and take a break. And so what happens is that when we live in that chronic stress state, and this is so common, right? This is common for everybody. Before I became ill with long COVID and I was working in physical therapy clinics, I would talk to my patients all the time about this. Like, you got to slow yourself down. You know, take some moments throughout the day to breathe, because a lot of times we wake up first thing in the morning and we're already in a sympathetic state. We're thinking about all the things we got to get done that day, getting the kids to their different activities and the big meetings and all those different things that we have. And so it's so common for people to just kind of live in a sympathetic state for most of the day. And so what happens then is, first of all, there are physiological changes that occur within the body when we're in that sympathetic nervous system state all the time. So what's important to note is that there is no difference in terms of the reaction and the response in the body between a lion is attacking me and I just have a lot going on. I've got these minor stressors that add up to be a lot, right? So in other words, if I'm thinking about trying to get my two kids to soccer practice and there's only one of me and they're in two different locations, or I'm trying to figure out what to make for dinner, or I have a big meeting later that I'm really worried about, the response within the body is the same as though there's a lion coming toward me. So you can think of it then like, what systems do I need in my body if there's a lion attacking me? Do you need your digestive system to be optimized? No. Do you need your reproductive system to be working well? No. Do you need your pancreatic function to be working well? Do you need your heart rate to be at this slow, steady pace? Do you need your hormones to be optimized? You don't need any of that. So it's literally as though the body goes through and dumps off systems that it doesn't need. And it's a matter of diverting resources towards what you need for survival in that moment. And much of this is accomplished in an acute stress state by your adrenaline, right? Adrenaline is coming online and it's affecting all these systems. As the stress becomes more chronic, cortisol takes over. And then cortisol has an even stronger impact on some of these other systems. So adrenaline also does impact our immune system. It slows our immune function. Once the stress becomes chronic, the cortisol takes over and cortisol impacts the immune system even further. Cortisol increases blood pressure. It shuts off our reproductive system. It increases weight gain and is associated with obesity. And then as far as that immune function goes, it's going to slow our immune function and increase the release of inflammatory cytokines. So now we've got poor immune function, and we've got increase in inflammation, which we hear over and over again are at the underlying root cause of many chronic illnesses. Now, in addition, once the illness has developed, now the illness itself is becoming a stressor on the body, right? Both psychologically, emotionally, as well as physically. So what tends to happen is that then the individual switches, their nervous system flips into a sympathetic dominant state. And you may have heard me say that before in some of my shorts, that this is part of what the research is finding, is that people with chronic illness, their nervous system is no longer operating in a parasympathetic dominance, it's operating in a sympathetic dominance. So we've got that continued chronic stress load and cortisol flowing. Cortisol also increases short-term memory loss, sleep disturbance, decreased focus and concentration, appetite changes. It increases the sensitivity of our tissues, changes in bowel and bladder function, increases inflammation, and decreases blood flow to our tissues. So, and these sound very similar to a lot of the symptoms that I hear, particularly my clients that I work with that have long COVID and chronic fatigue syndrome. Those are the symptoms that they describe, right? Sensitive tissues, sensitive muscles, pain throughout the body, in their tissues, memory loss, sleep disturbance. Those are all common symptoms. And so the nervous system, again, has flipped into that sympathetic dominant state, and the goal is to reverse that. So where does vagus nerve stimulation come into this? So vagus nerve stimulation is actually increasing the activity within your vagus nerve. And the vagus nerve contains 75 to 80% of your parasympathetic nervous system's nerve fibers. So when you're stimulating the vagus nerve, what you're doing is you're actually giving the body an opportunity to move back into a parasympathetic nervous system state and to really recreate the conditions for health and healing. And the vagus nerve stimulation increases the tone of the vagus nerve. So even when you don't have the stimulation on, your vagus nerve is more active than it was prior to you beginning vagus nerve stimulation. So you're creating the conditions, again, that that optimize the function of all of those different systems in the body that go through that shift when we're in the sympathetic nervous system state. So it's a matter of moving the body away from the sympathetic dominance that really allows all those shifts to occur. And we get a drop in the cortisol, a drop in the adrenaline, and the body finds homeostasis again. So I hope that clarifies some things for you in terms of what vagus nerve stimulation does and why it starts to shift the body away from that chronic stress state. And if you are looking for more guidance on how to begin vagus nerve stimulation safely, my recovery course walks you through it step by step. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you for being part of this community. Please comment, let me know what other things you'd like for me to talk about, what else I can cover that is going to be useful for you in your recovery journey. And we will, and I will keep listening and keep making videos that are relevant to you. So thank you for being here, and we will see you on the next one.